Good morning. Start your Bibles this morning. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 through 17. The title of our message this morning is The Ecstasy of Victory, The Agony of Defeat. Sound familiar? It's good to see everybody this morning. You know, I've said a couple of weeks that the Bible teaches that God's children desire a house to worship in. I did a little more research on that in Samuel, and it says God desires that his people worship in a house. Amen. So thank you, Lord, that we're in your house. Let's go to prayer and give him the thanks. Father God, we do thank you that we're in the assembly. And we know, Lord, that the building really isn't the body of Christ. It's the people that are in the building. We know that. But it is a blessing to come and to be able to have a place to assemble together, to see one another, to be with one another, for that community of fellowship. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of preaching the word of God. The words Christ said that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And Lord, may the word today have its way in our lives, in Christ's name. Amen. The ecstasy of victory, the agony of defeat. Did you ever have one of those days? Yeah. You wish you never got out of bed? Amen. You started believing because plan A, B, and C didn't work, that the devil was in the details. I had such a day. It was Wednesday, the 17th of June. It started having to take Groucho, my cat. You thought Groucho was out of the scenario, right? Well, here he is again. Hopefully, this is the last time Groucho is the main event. Yeah, I had to take him to the veterinarian. Gigi lent me that sky kennel. And, well, the day started with, how am I going to get this feisty cat Groucho into that box? Well, by the grace of God, I did. I got him in. I was getting ready to go to the vet. I put him on a chair on the porch. I didn't center it right. Next thing you know, I heard this crashing sound. The thing goes upside down, and the cat is out of control. I mean, he's screaming and hollering and everything. And you see, I broke the handles on the thing there. But anyway, I got the thing turned up, and every time I made a flip to get it in the right section, that cat got wilder and wilder. Then I went in the house, I got my stuff, I'm going out the door, I pick up the cat cage there, and I said, boy, this cat's heavy. And all of a sudden, the handle breaks. Down goes the cat again. Well, he starts up again. He is screaming and hollering and everything. I said, Barbara, I got to get out of here. I pick him up, get him in the car, and he's still going on. And by the time I got to Southern Boulevard, he had quieted down pretty good. I was thankful to the Lord. I get 3 miles down the road. I'm a little past Costco on Southern Boulevard. All of a sudden, I'm in my Mercedes, my small Mercedes. All of a sudden, something starts happening in my car. I feel it going like this, and all of a sudden, I feel like the car is going to turn over. I don't know what's happening. I look up to the left, and there's this semi-truck. He didn't see me. He moved into me. His tire caught the back of my car and started to flip me over. Well, by then, by the grace of God, he must have figured something was wrong. He pulls off, and thank God, that Mercedes corrected. I was going all over the road. It corrected. I got straight. I followed the guy for about a mile. He never stopped. He kept on going. We hit a red light. I got out of the car. I went up to the guy. He's in the front there. I said, you hit me. He said, no, I didn't. He was a Latin guy. No, I didn't hit you. I said, you hit me. And by the grace of God, he had a brand new license plate on that semi. I said, I have your license plate right here, and I'm going to call the policeman right now. Well, that changed his attitude. So he said, okay, let's pull over. So we pulled over. I got out of my car. He started getting out of his truck. I reviewed the damage, and he didn't break anything. That tire just blackened the back left side of my car. And I figured right then there's no use calling any insurance because it wouldn't even cover the deductible. So the guy gets out and he's almost crying, and he starts to apologize. And so then we had a good talk. I said, man, you could have killed me. I'm sorry, I didn't see you. And my blind spot. I said, okay, look, I'm not going to call the cops. I'm not going to even report to the insurer, but be careful, please. And by the grace of God, I always carry tracts with me. I had about a 3-minute conversation with him and gave him a gospel. He was so thankful. And we go down the road. I don't get a mile and a half down the road. I'm this side of the turnpike. I'm doing 55 to 60 miles an hour. I look in the right lane, and here's this giant iguana. I went in big boys, and I'm thinking, oh, man, he's pointed in my direction. I said, what am I going to do? I couldn't go left, traffic. I couldn't go right. So I figured I'll lean a little to the left, and I'll hit the accelerator, and at 550, I got big engine, and boy, I did. I hit that accelerator, and that car rocketed off, and as soon as I hit it, he makes a go for it. I hit him dead center with the front of my car. I'm looking in the mirror. You ever seen an iguana doing backflips 2 feet off the ground? And I'm thinking to myself, what next? What next? That's already 5 scenarios. So I get to the vet, I leave him there, and so I'm coming back home. So I stop at Publix, I have to draw out an exceptional amount of money out of the ATM to pay for something, a kind of money I never draw out of there. I put my card in, I go through the whole process, I pull my card out, what happens? No money comes out. No money comes out. So anyway, I go into the store. I said, lady, is anybody complaining that your ATM machine is broken? I drew out this amount of money, and I didn't get any money back. And she says, well, I don't think so. She calls the manager. He was really nice. He checked the machine out. It says, okay. So he said, you want to try it again? I'm like, yeah, try it again. Lose another X amount of money. I said, okay, we went out. And I went through the situation again, and it gave me the money I needed. But then I had to go home, call the bank, and find out if it didn't double dip on me. So that was Wednesday, the 17th. And I'm sure that every one of you here can look back in the narrative of your life, and you know you had one of those days. Nothing went right. We call that maybe the agony of defeat. Amen. How many times has each and every one of us said, Lord, why me? Lord, why me? You know, well, according to the Bible, the good book, the why me's are what inevitably God uses to give us the ecstasy of victory. Trials and testings and problems, the frustrations of the Christian life are part of the scenario as well as the triumphs that we have. All through the scriptures, we find that they are to mature us in the faith and get us ready for the appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So in order for us to maintain the peace of God that passes all understanding, daily, weekly, or whatever, we have those days where our lives are totally upside down. If you recall in our first message on June the 1st, it was the opening of our sanctuary here. Paul warns of the afflictions that all believers will face. He said in 2 Corinthians 4, 8, 9, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not forsaken, cast down but not destroyed. And he said later on that same text in 2 Corinthians 4:17, for our light affliction is but for a moment, it's going to pass. And it works for us a far more exceeding and eternal hope of glory. You know, the agonies and the ecstasies of the Christian walk are summed up in our message today in one word, sanctification. Sanctification. It's defined as separation to God or to be holy. Vine's expository book says it is used in the New Testament of the separation of the believer from all evil things and ways. So it's trying daily not to live a perfect or a sinless, holy, perfect life. No. But it's trying to be an example of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that takes trials, it takes tribulation as well as triumphs. It is to complete or to mature our faith. You know, last week we looked at part one at Brett McCracken's pyramid for our messages in the coming weeks. And we focused on the bottom one, the Bible, our daily bread. We divided it up into two different categories. One, salvation, and then today, sanctification. And I think that those two areas of our foundation of the Christian life are the most important aspects of our faith. Build upon this two, salvation and sanctification, and you will have a house that is built on a solid rock and not, as the Lord Jesus said, a house built on shifting sand. What are those two foundations? All of Holy Scripture, I think, hangs as the bedrock of salvation and the banner of sanctification. Let's simplify our headings last week. The bedrock of salvation, 20% of the Bible tells you how to get to heaven. The banner of sanctification, 80% tells you how to live your life until you get there. Again, last week, we dealt with the bedrock of salvation. We pointed to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 through 17. And in verse 14 and 15, young Timothy is told to steadfast in the crisis that he was having in Ephesus on the bedrock of that salvation which was taught to him as a child. In verse 14 and 15 of 2 Timothy says, "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise through salvation, through faith which is in Christ Jesus." You see, until a person is born again, until they are a new creature in Christ, by faith alone, anything else that's done in our present lifetime will go for nothing, zero. You see, without the new birth of salvation, everything at the final white throne judgment will be cast into the lake of fire. I pray that each of you, within the sound of my voice this morning, you have settled that in your heart, and you are confident of eternal life in heaven. And you know, I'm glad it's the Lord that keeps me and that I don't have to keep myself. I'd be in trouble. I say to myself every day, I walk around and say, "Lord, if I can't get through the pearly gates because of the cross alone, I'm dead in the water. I'm dead in the water. The sinner that I am, the sinner that we all are." But you know, Paul, writing to young Timothy, also said in chapter 1, verse 12, "For which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed. And I am persuaded that he, Christ, is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day." Wow, that day is the rapture. He is able to keep what I have committed, what I have deposited. All my marbles are deposited in the cross and nothing else. And God's going to keep that. That verse also is beautifully brought out in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. It talks about God, because of salvation, giving us a what? A reservation in heaven. This is better than the Ritz-Carlton, right? A reservation. And it said that he is able to keep again. The word keep means to build a fortress around. The devil can't get it. Nobody else can get in it. And we are safe and we are sound. You know, I love the anecdote, and I've used it many times here, of the great preacher Charles Haddon Spurgeon on the total, complete assurance that we have of eternal life, which 80% of other professing Christians cannot give you. He said this. He was so sure of his salvation that he could grab on to a corn stalk and swing out over the fires of hell and look straight into the face of the devil and sing, "Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine." Oh boy. I hope that's a prayer that all of you can identify with. So today, our part two, the banner of sanctification. Here's where the 80% comes in. Now that I'm saved, how then shall I live? Verse 16 of 2 Timothy contains four areas that the Holy Spirit will mature in our lives. Look at verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. See, the word of God is God-breathed. 2 Peter 1, 20-21 said, holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Unbelievers, when you start to talk to them about the Bible all the time, you say, well, the Bible was written by men. You know, well, sure, God anointed and through the breathing of the Holy Spirit, through them, anointed them to put down on papyrus what God wanted to communicate to the world, but it is God-breathed. God wrote the Bible, not man. And because the Holy Spirit of God breathed, they are capable of thoroughly qualifying a person for every good work. You get that? When we're talking about living out the life. The Bible is capable of thoroughly qualifying a person for every good work. And every good work is our sanctification. We say all the time, you're not saved by your works, but you have to work out your salvation. You are accountable to that. Look at verse 17. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Why? That the man of God, that the woman of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works, thoroughly qualified to do the will of God. The word perfect there doesn't mean without sin. It means complete or mature. Again, you don't go to heaven by your good works, but the Bible said you are to work out your salvation for eternal rewards when we get to heaven at the Bema seat. And as we mature in our faith, our good works, as even Christ said, stores up treasures in heaven. Stores up treasures in heaven. That's what works are for rewards, not for salvation. Faith in Christ alone secures salvation, but working out your salvation earns eternal rewards. The maturation process that every Christian goes through requires some agony along with the ecstasy. Let's look now in verse 16 at these four areas the Bible through the Holy Spirit uses to complete or mature or perfect us in the faith. Number one, the God-breathed word is profitable for doctrine. Profitable, sufficient, useful, beneficial, advantageous for doctrine. Correct doctrine, which is teaching, is a necessity for truth. Even in professing Christianity, there are multitudes of doctrines out there. And even churches that pretty much have the truth in a line, in order for them to grow into mega churches, you have to avoid doctrine. You can't preach doctrine, even though they may believe in it. But there are multitudes of doctrines, even in professing Christendom. False. You know, my wife and I learned years ago, too, someone taught us that wrong doctrine leads to wrong living. That's why you look at people who are professing that they are Christians and their life is a total mess. You look at them and you say, that person's not saved. He can't be. Look at the life they're living. Look what they believe and they call themselves Christians. Wrong doctrine will lead to wrong living. If you're not saved and born again and you have the Holy Spirit sealing you from within, there's no telling what you will do. And churches won't be doctrine. They say doctrine divides. Yeah, it does. It divides truth. It chases truth out the door and allows everybody to feel comfortable there in whatever they believe about God, right? And you know, that proves itself out daily in the church. There's so much counterfeit doctrine out there. We don't even have time to scratch the surface. Just a couple, maybe. The prosperity gospel. Give God a dollar, he'll give you two. That's garbage. Don't ever follow any of those guys. And we could go on. The modern day tongues movement, let me tell you, beloved. If you study the doctrine, if you study the doctrine, if you're very serious about 1 Corinthians 12, 13, particularly 14, you will see that the modern day tongues movement, charismatic movement, does not fit with the Bible. Does not fit with the Bible. Let's be honest. I don't care what this person says they are experiencing. And when you have worldwide global conventions that invite faiths from all over the world, and they're all speaking in tongues, and many, most of them are not even Christian faiths, you tell me where that spirit comes from. We could go on. We don't have time to go on. But you know, everyone loves Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. How beautiful. Those of you who have been to Israel, when you go there, you go up to the Sea of Galilee. You sit on the northern part of the Sea of Galilee. And you read out of the Beatitudes. And you just see how powerful that sermon was that Jesus preached. And the people that were there that day on the slopes of the Sea of Galilee, who had already seen and experienced some of the miracle-making power of God. The Lord Jesus Christ finishes that sermon, Matthew 7, 28, 29. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended all these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. For he taught as one having authority, not as the scribes. Go on, the Apostle Paul in the book of Acts, chapter 13, on his first missionary journey. When a false prophet by the name of Bar-Jesus came to him, challenging him, Paul blinded him on the spot. But there was one deputy called Sergio Paulus who was there really seeking the God. And the false prophet, Bar-Jesus, was trying to discourage him and showing him that his magic was a lot more powerful. When Bar-Jesus saw what Paul had done and listened to the teachings of the Apostle Paul, verse 12, it says, then the deputy, Sergio Paulus, when he saw what was done, he believed. He believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. You see, that's how important doctrine really is. So the first God-breathed scriptures matures us in doctrine. You have to know what you believe and why you believe it and stand up for that. Then second, it is profitable or useful for reproof. Doctrine teaches us what is right. Reproof teaches us what is wrong. It reveals our errors. It convicts us when we are out of the Lord's will. The Bible gives warnings. Warnings must go out to the church of Jesus Christ. We only have to look at the biblical history. Even God's own people, the Jews, we love the Jews. We support the Jews. Our Savior was a Jew. But unfortunately, the Jews have not always obeyed the Almighty God, their Jehovah, and the Scriptures. Deuteronomy chapter 28, go back and read it. Before the children of Israel were ready to go into the wilderness, in chapter 28, Moses had all the beatitudes of goodness for them. If you do this, if you obey me in this, if you will be blessed. But also he warned them of the cursings. If you do not obey the word of God, all of these cursings, 40 or 50 different verses on how they would be cursed. Look at the history of Israel. They have been in hot water ever since the beginnings because they refused to rely on the Holy Scriptures. The ultimate problem with them was the rejection of their own Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And they will go through the tribulation. The majority of Jewish people will go for the tribulation because in Israel today, less than 10% are even attending the synagogues. It's really sad. What about you and I? How do we profit? Does the Bible tell us what is wrong? Sure it does. It reveals our errors. Christians many times try to qualify their sin, ignoring the doctrines of the Lord. You're in conversations with a lot of Christians, and you know maybe they're not living the kind of life that they need to be living according to the Word of God. You'll be in a conversation with them, and you're asking God for some wisdom to, how am I going to speak to this person? And they say, well, I think. Well, you know, think is your opinion about something. But my wife lets them run the course and always says, you know what? You can think, but what I function on is, thus saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord. When the Lord speaks, our opinions stick, and they are not justified when it comes for truth. All the words of Solomon in chapter 7, verse 17 in the book of Ecclesiastes, be not wicked overmuch. Why should you die before your time? Christian thinks he can be born again and be saved, and he can, and then go live like the devil. He's on thin ice, ladies and gentlemen, and I've heard too many testimonies of people going before their time because they refused to right the wrongs in their lives, you know? And sin is sin, no matter what they're going through. Just put it up there. You know what's right. Everybody has a conscience that tells them what is right and wrong. So doctrine tells us what is right. Reproof tells us what is wrong. Our third heading, God-breathed Holy Scripture, is for correction. It tells us how to remedy the error or how to get it right. If reproof stresses the negative aspect of Christian living, then correction emphasizes the positive. It directs us on how to get on the right path. Does not the gospel teaching our Lord Jesus Christ tell us that there is a broad way that leads to what? Destruction. But there's a narrow way that leads to life. He's talking about the Christian life. You want to live like the devil and get on the broad path, which is easy to get on? Do is go about three blocks down the street and you're going to find something that's pulling you in. You're going to suffer. You're going to be in a lot of agony, let me tell you. But try to live the life of Christ and get on that narrow street. The God-breathed word is to guide and direct us on how to stay on the right path. How many of you read Bunyan's great book, Pilgrim's Progress? How many of you read that book? Well, you need to read it. My goodness, so many people here haven't. I mean, other than the Bible, it's probably one of the most popular read. Great illustration. Christian is trying to get to the celestial city, which is heaven. And he gets on the path that his mentor tells him, you stay on that path and you'll go right to the pearly gates. But what does Christian do? He meets all kinds of temptations. And every time he yields to that temptation to do wrong, what happens? He's in deep trouble. And he barely gets out with his life every time. It's a great book. And that pretty much describes what it is not to obey the Lord and not to remedy what the problem is. The word remedies the error, tells us how to get it right. And our last heading, the God-breathed word gives instruction in righteousness. Instruction, training, or discipline, or how to keep it right. Once we get it right, how do we keep it right? That's a big problem, isn't it? Once we kind of get a hold of what solid Christianity is in, to try to stay on that path, it's almost impossible. Read the Apostle Paul, chapter 7 of Romans. 30-something years being born again and saved, and he complains that, man, there's still things in my life I want to do and I can't do them, things that I do and I don't want to do. So it's tough. It's difficult to stay on that path. How to keep it right. And the word righteousness literally means right livings. But it says all believers for instruction. We have to be trained, disciplined by the word of God. This is necessary so that one may prosper in the sphere where God's will is considered normative. And righteousness refers to right living. That should be the normal thing of our life. You know, living in our culture today is totally out of control. We're all fearful of what's going to happen to our nation if we don't get some kind of control over what's going on. The lawlessness, the COVID-19, how that's tying in. Francis Schaeffer wrote a book called The Great Evangelical Disaster. Evangelical disaster. Putting the hurts on Christians. And the whole theme of that book was the assassination of common sense. Do you see that happening today? You look at what some of these men and women are doing, and you say, how in the world can they make that kind of a decision? Flies in the face of common sense. It comes out of our government today, on both sides of the fence. And it trickles down to the man on the street. The assassination of common sense. To think that the leadership of many scenarios in this country are allowing mob violence to take control blows my mind. It's not right living. And you know, the sad thing about it is that all of these acts of lawlessness, ungodliness, things that obviously are coming right out of the dark side of hell, the people involved in these things have no conviction that this is a sin. They're honestly convinced that what they're doing is right. They put their hand on the book. They wouldn't do that, but anyway, whatever. No conviction. And when you function in life with no conviction of sin, there's going to be total anarchy. Total anarchy. Solomon, in Proverbs 28, verse 1, can help us, I think. And by the way, Solomon 28, verse 1, all four of my children went to the King's Academy for education. This is the theme verse of that school. Proverbs 28, verse 1. The wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion. To which I love Pastor Charles Parkhouse commented, the wicked flee when no man pursueth, but they make better time when the righteous go after them. The wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous, they make better time when the righteous go after them. So what are we saying? Don't bow the knee to any evil that comes before you that violates the assassination of common sense, but you go after them. Stand your ground on the word of God. Stand your ground on the word of God. Don't faint, don't run, but boldly, face to face, chase the bullies away. The wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion. In the meantime, why not hide verse 16 in your heart? It defines the ecstasy of victory and the agony of defeat. The Bible is profitable for doctrine, what is right. The Bible is profitable for reproof, what is wrong. The Bible is profitable for correction, how to get it right. And the Bible is profitable for instruction in righteousness, how to keep it right. I want to thank Pastor Norm for that little anecdote decision. How to keep it right. In closing, again, our title today was The Ecstasy of Victory, The Agony of Defeat. The word agony is in the Bible. It's the Greek agonia. We get our English agony. It's only used one time in the Gospel, Luke chapter 22, verse 44. Jesus is in the garden. He's hours from his arrest and conviction and crucifixion. The scripture says that he was in agony. Agony denotes severe emotional strain and anguish. Severe emotional strain and anguish. And verse 40 says, and being in agony, Christ, his sweat as it was, great drops of blood falling to the ground. That agony pointed to his physical death on a cruel cross. Now to anyone maybe in this church, anyone in the world who is not saved, who is not born again, who does not have the new nature of Jesus Christ working in them, the agony of spiritual death in hell transcends any physical death anyone will ever experience. Trust Jesus, ladies and gentlemen. Trust him completely for your salvation. That he, God in the flesh, suffered under Pontius Pilate, shed his blood, was nailed to a cross, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. That agony that Christ suffered was for the sins of the world. And if anyone will put their faith and trust in Christ alone, not by any good works that we have done, but according to his mercy has saved us. If you trust in him alone for eternal life, you'll never face the agony of defeat in hell, but you'll have the ecstasy of victory forever in heaven. Father, thank you again for that love in Jesus Christ and that grace that so free salvation in your name. Amen.
Good morning, Maranatha. It is amazing to be in God's house. Let's all stand on our feet and praise the God together.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you know evil or victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There's power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There's power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily as praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. heaven's throne, acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe, your suffering for our freedom. The Lamb of God, in my place, your blood poured out, my sin erased. It was my death you died, I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God. My name upon your heart, my shame upon your shoulders, the power of sin for my salvation. The Lamb of God in my place, your blood poured out, my sin erased. It was my death you died, I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God. There is no greater love, there is no greater love. The Savior lifted it up, there is no greater love, there is no greater. Sin erased, it was my death you died, I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of some wonder, consider all the works thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. God his son not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died. Take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great. Shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God. How great thou art, how great thou art.